I'm working at Strabag. I'm the team lead of a small team of 3 persons, and today I would like to give you a bright overview about what we are doing at Strabag with Docker, for example. But you can just insert another containerization software or a technology in there as you like. You can just use Kubernetes or Mesos, for example. We have done our way to DevOps with Docker. We are using Docker in native. We are using Docker Swarm. We are using Docker Swarm in production. And yes, we are doing CI/CD. And of course, we are also providing the automatically deployment stuff. But before we are jumping in my presentation, I would like to ask you, who of you is doing the operational tasks at your work? Who is the operator? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, nearly the half of the people are operators. Nice to see, because they're usually more developers than operators, but in my opinion, it should be the same. It should be teams of guys and men at work who are developing together the infrastructure to deploy the services. My talk is divided in 3 parts. The first part is a little introduction of who we are, what we are doing at work, and how we are doing it, and where the problems are residing, where the problems were. The second part is the transition, which we made last year, in the beginning of last year. We are just using Docker from the beginning of 2017. And then there will be a short demo in between. Hopefully it is all working like I expected. And in the last part, in the third part, I will give you some conclusion and a summary about maybe what you have learned, which lessons we have learned, and maybe there's something in there you can use on your side too. So let's start with the introduction. It's one number, 1,545. It's just, okay, a big number. What does it mean? This is the number of services we have to sustain at work. So we have 1,545 services, which we are using, and which we have to deploy in production, which we have to deploy in testing environments, in staging environments, in education environments, and so on. This number is quite impressive because it consists of 580 Docker OpenVZ containers. I don't know if anyone ever had used OpenVZ for containerization. Whoa, 1, great. 2, 3, 4, yeah, cool. OpenVZ was born in 2005 and was nearly one of the first container applications which were running under Linux, for example. In before there were other systems like FreeBSDJs and so on, but we are using OpenVZ and we are using it still until today. Then we have in this number about 380 containers running, up and running in production already. We started last year, I told you before. Then we have to have in this number a lot of load balancers. We have 280 load balancers. We have this huge number of load balancers because our services are not spent about 1,000 of containers, for example. We have a lot of software. I knew from Google that they have approximately 18 services, software products. We have 120. So we have a lot of load balancers in before them because some of the backends are only consisting of, for example, 3 containers or 4 containers. They are small applications, but we have a lot of different applications to manage and to host, of course. Then also in this number is another interesting point. We use some infrastructure services, for example. We have to use SMTP servers and we have to use NFS servers too, because we have to provide some infrastructure for the whole Docker environment as such. The summary of it is this 1,545 services. Now there comes one number again. 3. 3 is much lower than 1,500. But what does this mean? Any clue? Yes. My team is consisting of 3 people, 2 colleagues of mine, and myself. I am here today. 1 colleague is ill. And 1 is at the office. And we are still able to manage this number of services without any problem. So you are able to manage this if you go down the automatization way, if you look at CI/CD, and if you are going to try to put your applications in productive mostly automatically. So this is really important today. Why I told you that? It's because just imagine you have cars. You have 1,500 cars. And you have three people to maintain. So you have a problem. You just have to refill 1,500 cars. You have to make a yearly service of it, and so on. So it would be a really tough task to make this without any automatization. So you have to really strip out the manual tasks. And if you don't do this, then you have a problem, which we had also 1.5 years, 1 year ago. You lose something really important for your tasks, and this is time. If you're losing time and you don't have the time to be innovative and creative, you lose, in the end, your environment. Because you cannot be creative and innovative if you have no time to work on your new services and to bring something new to your system. And something more about this number, manpower is not a solution. If you just raise this number, you have other problems. You have the problem you must communicate with more people. You have the problem that you might have to switch the tasks between two people. You have a communication problem, and so on. So manpower is not the only solution, and it will not be a solution in this case. So in fact, at the end, if you don't get the time you need for your innovation, you lead to this guy. It's a small guy. He has an ops cap on it. It's called my ops guy. And this guy is trapped in the quicksand of work. So let's imagine if you're just trying to manage your work as you do it now, for example, yes, and you try to get out of this trap. The more you try to get out and the more you try to solve your problems, the more you will be stuck in the quicksand. And you have no chance to get out of it besides change your processes and change your management of the services. So, in fact, we had a problem. It was time, because if you have no time, you cannot be innovative, you cannot be creative, you cannot change any tasks, you cannot bring your software, your code faster in production. You have to find other ways. And that's where our move to the other system or our change started 1 year ago. So we are coming to the transition of a classic system, a classic management, classic server deployment. You have to bring up the virtual machines. You have to bring up, I don't know, the load balancers by hand, and so on and so on. There are a lot of manual tasks, and these tasks are a really problem because they all cost time. So as someone told you in the morning, there should be more automatization. There should be more automatically automatization. That's also what we like to achieve in the next years, I would say. This should be done automatically most of the time. So just before we come to the solution, some historic information about where we come from. As I told you before, we started with the OpenVZ here in 2006. We started in 2006. This was the time where I met also Peter. He helped us a lot to get our Tomcat installations up and running. We have a lot of Tomcats, these 580 OpenVZ container, and also the Docker containers are running mostly Apache Tomcats on it. A lot of Apache Tomcats on it. So we had to decide 10 years ago, or a little bit more than 10 years ago, that we have to use containers or we get stuck in the quicksand of time because we were not able to make this lot of machines with VMware back then. Why we would like to change from the OpenVZ? There is no tooling around OpenVZ. So we have to have program all on your own. We had to just reinvent some wheels because there is no tool. There is no such thing like images, for example. And images, also as we learned in the morning, are really important because it makes the things immutable. So if we have to deploy a container on OpenVZ, we have to unpack and tarball, I would say, and then we have to assign an IP address and so on and so on. And this is all a lot of manual work. That's the benefit of Docker, for example, but you can just use another orchestration software like Kubernetes or something else. It's just a change of how you do things. Then we come to friends. Why friends? Friends are important, like Peter I is important, and the other guys from the P42. Why? You need to meet people like you because you have ideas, you have different maybe opinions, you have different views of your problems, and each view is important because it just extends your horizon of what you can achieve and what you can do. So we met some guy too, the right one is I am. The middle guy is a colleague of mine, he's at the office now, and the left guy is Kirill Kolishkin. We met him at the Linux Day 2009 in Berlin. He's one of the kernel developers who worked at Parallels. And Parallels did a lot of kernel changes. For example, the process ID namespaces I mean, which were made by OpenVZ and are in the kernel, in the vanilla kernel right now. And he was one of the guys who did a lot of kernel development. He worked about 10 years, I guess, for Parallels. And since the last year, he made a change. Now he works at Docker Incorporated in San Francisco, and we are still in contact. So it's really important that you meet some friends along your way. When you go down the DevOps way, you maybe met a lot of people, but stay in contact with them. They have ideas, they can help you, and of course they have maybe some clues on your changes and your things to do. Now the problem, or the problems. The problem we had was, as I said before, time. But where was the time lost? The most of the time we lost by manually applying IP addresses for the containers in the OpenVZ environment. Because you, like we have 1,500 services, you have to manage a lot of IP addresses. And of course, you have to know which IP addresses are free, which are not free. You have to provide some, for example, an IP address management. You have to know which services are going out of maintenance. Where are the free IP addresses left? What to do? The next thing is with OpenVZ, you cannot scale easily. Today, or in the morning, we talked about load balancing and service scaling in Kubernetes, for example. You can just change the number of replicas and the services come up, and then you have 5, 50, 500, 5,000 containers of a software because you're immutable. That's not possible in the OpenVZ environment as such. So therefore, we have lost a lot of time if we have to provide the containers every time on your own. The next thing is why time is one of the greatest problems. Just imagine the following. You have, like we have a lot of Tomcat containers, more than 500, and you have to change your Tomcat version from one release to another. Can you imagine what does this mean? You have to build all the services in parallel and then move from one infrastructure to another infrastructure, and you all build it by hand. So you have a really tough task to do, and in our case, the transition from Docker, from Tomcat 6 to 7 needs 22 months. So with three people, what alternatives you have? You can only just set up new Tomcats and then move. And this application by application by application. The developers were not able to do it on their own because this was only an operational stuff. So only we as operators were in the position to make the root changes, to build up new services. There was no way a developer was able to just scale a service or to just do anything in the technology environment, in the productive, for example. So that's one of the most impressive problems we had. And at least, as I said it before, the separation of operating and development is the baddest idea ever you can do. Because a developer, for example, just drops a packet to the operating and then turn around and go away. You as operator have the task, you maybe don't know what the application needs, you don't know maybe how many replicas you need to pull up, you have no clue about memory management, you don't know nothing. Eh? And therefore, this wall between the operators and the developer is really a bad idea and it makes only problems. So we had to decide what we should do next. And yes, we just go on and move ahead. Why we move? As I told you before, we had a lot of problems. And yes, we tried Docker back in 2014, I guess, was the first time, as Peter told us, guys, there is Docker, there is containerization, there are images, just try it. We tried it, but it didn't work. It didn't work because load balancing problems, no overlay network, no swarm management, and so on. So there were different problems we had in the past where we were not able to move to Docker at this point. What the problem was, once more, if you have to maintain a lot of services, you need something like the YAML files for Swarm or for Kubernetes, the pods and so on. You just have to pull in your environment into infrastructure as code, I would say. Not the virtual machines behind them in the first step, but you have to you need the possibility to describe your services you would like to power up. And if you are able to do that, then you made a move. And why I said this, just to be clear at this point, production is the only measurement of success. If you have code and the code is not in production, it has no value at all. So you are only burning your resources. You're developing, for example, in software. The ops department is just programming a load balancer, for example. But if this code or this infrastructure is not going into production, there's no value of it. So the only measurement is production. If you are able to push your code, your services, whatever, into production, you have value. And this is success. So we come to the solution, how we did it. I don't know if someone has read the book DevOps, a Phoenix Project. Yeah, you're the right guys here. There are 4 types of work in this book. You can read it on your own and you find it on Google with just these keywords. In my opinion, and what we have done with our team or what we have achieved with our team are 3 points I would like to explain to you. 3 important points in my opinion or in our opinion. It's just our way. You may have another way. Do it like you need it, but we have found 3 points. The first is knowledge. Each of these points is a knowledge point, for example. Yeah? Just take the knowledge you have. And with knowledge, I mean you need knowledge about your services. You need also knowledge about your work. You need knowledge about your problems. You need knowledge what is going on with your services. Where are you and where would you like to go? And this does not mean that you need knowledge in a technical stuff or in a technical way. If you need technical knowledge, there are guys out there like you here in this room or like Peter with the B42 or some other consultants, they can help you. They can help you to bring up your technology environment. They can help you. But they can't help you if you don't know where your problems are. If you just go, for example, in a restaurant and say, I'm hungry, then the waiter will say, okay, and what would you like to eat? Because if you don't know your problems, you will have no chance to get the right information in time. And a second, you need experience. Experience is also important because as you're sitting here in this room, you are the only one who have the experience with your environment. No one else. You are the only one who knew what is going wrong? You have the experience and you are the only one who can make the change. If you are not making the change, no one else can do it because you have the experience in your environment, you have the experience in your infrastructure, and you alone have the experience to get something done. But where is Docker in this example, or where is the cloud or the containerization technology? To be clear, Docker is software. Images are software. Everything is software at this point, and Docker, Kubernetes, or something else won't save any problems for you if you don't have the knowledge and the experience about what you're doing. So the three point, or the real point, and the third point on this presentation slide is the point: what can do the or what does the containerization technology can do to you? It's pretty simple. It's creativity. If you have the time, or if you get the time back to be creative, you can just make new things. If you are creative, you can be innovative. And if you are innovative, you are able to do the things faster and more efficiently than in the past. So at the end, it comes down to the point that it doesn't matter what you take. Take what you need, take what you like, take what you are familiar with, for example, take Kubernetes, take what you want. At the end, it is only important that you just save time. Time is the really important thing. If you are not able to cut down the time to go with your code from testing or from staging to production, you are losing all what you have. Because if you lost time, you have no time to learn. And if you have no time to learn, you cannot be creative. If you can't be creative, you are not innovative. And at some point, you are stuck in the quicksand of time and you have no chance to get out of there. So you have to save time at the end. And Docker and, of course, other containerization technologies and technology can help you to achieve this. Now it comes a short demo. Some words on it. As I told you in the beginning, we have a lot of load balancers and we have a lot of Tomcat servers. And in the coffee breaks, I just listened to you what you are discussing here. Some guys are discussing about load balancing, for example, how to do load balancing, what is the best load balancer at the moment or not the best load balancer. We can drop money on F5, we can just use traffic, for example, we can use Nginx, we can use HA proxy, and so on. But in our case, the problem is that the best load balancer for Tomcat is? Huh? Anybody knows? Right, it's an Apache HTTPD, because there's a module in it, this is called a ModGK, and this combination is unbeaten. If you have a lot of Tomcats, then you would like to have an Apache HTTPD to make the load balancing. But as you know, Apache is not Docker aware or is not container aware, and it is not aware about service orchestration, and you have to just put around some code to bring the Apache Tomcat to use the service discovery, for example. And what I would like to show you now is a little bit hands-on with the load balancing with BosonD, for example. BosonD stands for Boatswain Daemon. It's a little tool we wrote on our own and it's open source. I will show you the page in a few seconds and I will show you how this is working with an Apache HTTPD, for example, in combination with Play with Docker Playground, to bring the things up and running. Therefore, I will just change my display so that you can see my workspace here. Hopefully. Just give me a sec. Just take some seconds until the beamer is back. at work. Yep. For the boson D, you can just went to our private GitHub repository, and there is boson D. It's open source. I wrote it with my two colleagues, and in this boson D, we are just using the Docker Swarm service discovery and pulling information down a bit, and we are trying to make something like, I don't know if someone is new in the configuration D, the conf D was a project where you were able to pull out information from an etcd cluster to make automatic configuration changes, and this is what we have done in a simple small Golang binary. There are examples in here that you can just use. For example, Apache HTTP D Tomcat. And if you are going in there, then there is a link. If you don't care about anything else, just click on try in PVD. And what then happens is the following. I've just started it before the presentation. If you have a Docker account, it will open up the labs play with docker.com, and it will automatically download the Docker stack file from the GitHub repository and bring up three services. One of it is the network service. The second service is the PVD HTTPD. And the third service is Tomcat. The stack is configured to power up two backend Tomcats. And if all is going well, then you have just a link here on port 80. It will be opened up and port on play with Docker. It's just a simple port expose. If you take the port 80, you can just get every service up and running, for example, a WordPress or whatever you want, and it works. No, this is just the starting page from the default HTTP daemon. That does nothing mean, but if I just put in the end JCar Manager, which is powering the JCar status page from the ModGK module, you can see that there are, in the backend, there are two working Tomcats at the moment. That's nothing great, but we also have just a little demo application there where you can just see your connection to the backend server and version test.gsp. There you can see that we are at the moment at the first backend. And if I just refresh the page, hopefully the session access count should go up. It's a simple counter. It's written by a dev colleague of mine who wrote us this demo application. So if I just refresh the page, I'm sticky to the backend Tomcat. Nothing great still here, but I can now go back to the Docker playground, for example. I can do a Docker service ls. Then you can see that there are two replicas at the moment working for the PVD Tomcat. Then I can do a Docker service scale PVD Tomcat is gleich 5. Then it will just take some seconds to bring up the new replicas on this service. And now we can head back to our demo. And I can just use JCar Manager once again. And now I have 5 Tomcats in the backend running. Okay, we can just make a test to be sure that we are not lying in production. It's not fair. So I should be still on the Tomcat 1, but I can just change my backend to, for example, we had 5 Tomcats. I can just use the number 5, refresh the page, and then I'm on my 5th Tomcat here, for example. And if I press the refresh button of the page, you can see that I'm sticky to the Apache, which is having Apache Tomcats in the backend. How does this work? Because the Apache has no clue about the backends that he has. So there is something in between, and of course, that's the boson demon. I can just give you some insight in it. Hopefully you can see it. I hope so. You can just go inside the container, Docker PS, Docker exec minus tie pvd httpd bash. In our example, we just use Ubuntu. It works for us. Point. Then we can go to the bosond environment. There's here sites enabled and the sites template folder. Like you see it also in the default Apache installation, default Apache HTTP installation. We go into the site templates, and everything we have done is nothing more than we just use the Golang template language to make something like this. As you can see here, we are just using the Golang template language to define our domain prefix, to define an index about the entries, about the labels. Here you can see the labels from the Docker. Service discovery, you can just label your services, and if the labels are seen on the network stack that is providing the backend services, then the bosond will just pick them up and will run over this template file and just give you the new configuration. And in our example, it does look the finally output of it is looks like this. I just take the siteconf, for example. It's a little bit down here, but it's not possible to. I would just try to move it a little bit up, but what you can see here is that after the bosond got the information from the Docker network infrastructure, he just take the template and fill in the correct information, put out the resulting configuration file, put it into a folder where the Apache is waiting for the configuration, and reload the service. The reloading and the configuration is done is done in the bosond. The configuration you can see online. You can just use a bosond YAML file, for example. You can just, here's the CMD section. You can take any daemon you would like. In our case, it is the HTTP foreground, like the official example from Apache is doing it. Then we have a reload command. You can take a reload command from your daemon like you need it. You have to specify a process name. The process name is needed that the bosond can look in the proc file system to find the running process. If it dies or it is going to a zombie process, he will kill it. Then you can specify the templates. You have, in this example, a site configuration and the worker. So you have one source file and the second source file and the destination file. Then you have the swarm configuration. Here is the PVD net that we specified. Then you can also specify the labels. It's documented in the GitHub repository. If you like, you can use Prometheus to enable a metric interface so that you knew how many times the configuration was reloaded during the run of this load balancer. Then you can, for example, power up an HTTP interface to reload the Apache HTTPD from the outside. Why would you like to do that? Any idea? Maybe you would like to use Let's Encrypt certificates, and they were updated and they are residing on a disk or in shared volume, and sometime if no configuration changes is made, you have to reload the Apache so that he can pick up the new certificates, for example. And also in the last version, we have integrated a cron daemon that you can use also in the HTTP daemon or in this boson daemon to just give them a time slot where he should, for example, restart once a day to pick up, of course, second to the Let's Encrypt certificates. So that's about the boson daemon at this time. Hopefully it is something in there you can just see at your side too, or maybe you can need it. So we switch back to the rest of the presentation. If my display is coming back. or not. Yep. Just give me a sec. Yes. So we can just continue on this page. I had provided a second demo, but I guess we will strip that out because it's a little bit late. But you can just talk to me. We are doing our CI/CD stuff and also the continuous deployment, everything with GitLab. Why GitLab? We had GitLab, or we have GitLab since 5 years. You can just use Jenkins or whatever you like. We are doing it with GitLab, for example. Why you would like to use a CI/CD pipeline like it is in GitLab, and why you would like to do it automatically or continuous deployment too? You will never want to publish services by manual and by hand, because if you do that, you are also lost. Because if you have no, if you cannot reproduce what you are doing, and if there is not configuration driven or triggered by something like GitLab or Jenkins, and you have a lot of services like we have, you are not able to just monitor, just get a feeling of it, what is going on in your services. So the only thing you can do on this is to just use a software or to just use a process which will enable the deployment of your services automatically. All other things, you don't ever publish services by hand or manually. That will lead to nothing. So the conclusion, lessons learned. The lessons we have learned was don't focus on tools too early, because it's a little bit of a problem, because if you don't have the basic information about what you're doing, for example, with the containers, with the images and so on, you are just running out of time and you are getting the wrong way, or you don't focus on your target which you would like to achieve. Then we have, of course, challenges. We have to make more automatization. Infrastructure as code is essential for us because we are doing all this stuff on-prem, so we are providing our Docker hosts on our own. So we have to patch them, we have to update them, and so on and so on. And this is today manually task, but it has to be automated as soon as possible. Of course, next challenge is that Microsoft and Linux, in case of containers, are coming together more and more. So I'm sure that we have to provide in the future Microsoft containers to bring other services up and running. And I see this as chance, not as risk, of course. Then what you are getting back, time saving and flexibility, like I said before. You don't have to do configuration management for all of your servers as you did it before. So we have a large Puppet Master installation still up and running, but the Docker infrastructure, the container infrastructure is changing this too really fast. And you can contribute, of course, you should contribute. If you get time back, just make some open source projects or open up some issues there. There are always guys who need your help, or write documentation, do whatever you want, but please try to contribute. There are different ways to get in touch with Docker, for example. Use the channels. There are a lot of people out there, nice people out there. You can talk to them. You can just discuss with them your problems and your needs. And the second last slide is choose what is working. That's a short video. It's about a minute, which I would like to display now. It's about a professor of the Technical University in Vienna who died back in 2014. And he just say something that is very inspiring to me. Just have a look at it.
Begonnen wurde das Beilifterlassen in der Kussa-Straße in der Technischen Universität. Und ich hatte eine seltsame Chance. Ich hatte keinen Chef. Ich nahm mir einfach die Freiheit, einen Computer zu bauen. Und es hat mich niemand aufgehalten.
Äußerlich steckt das Mailüfterl in einem relativ großen Gestell drinnen, also über 2 Meter hoch und einige Meter breit.
Das Mailüfterl bestand im Wesentlichen aus 3000 Transistoren und 5000 Dioden. Es gab ja noch keine Computerzeitschriften und nur ganz wenige Bücher über Computer. Also man musste sich die Information wirklich einzeln sozusagen zusammenholen, damit man genügend weiß, um einen Computer zu bauen. Und dadurch bin ich sehr rasch vom Elektroingenieur zum Programmierer geworden. Ich bin meinem Kern nach ein Ingenieur. Und das heißt, wahr ist, was funktioniert.
Yeah, so I think there's nothing more, really more to say. Just a few words. Take what works for you. Take maybe Docker, take Kubernetes, take Jenkins, take whatever you like. In the end, the only thing which is really important is choose what is working for you. Thank you.